Welcome to the second of the free BJCP prep course classes. Today we're going to be covering score sheets, why they're important, why it's important to fill out a good score sheet, the various parts of a score sheet, and how to fill one out properly for your exam and for competition. So why is it important to fill out a good score sheet? Well, because bad score sheets suck. That's why. Sadly, there's a lot more bad score sheets that are shown out there on the web than I'd care to see personally, but it happens, and I guess the best thing we can do is if you really hate it and you want to get out there and judge, go out there and be a good judge and do a good job of filling out a good score sheet, being as honest as you can with the entrant, and just do the best you can. Entrants pay money into a competition. We can never lose sight of that. You know, if it was your money that you sent into a competition, you deserve to get good feedback on why you are getting the score that you did, maybe why you didn't place, or even why you did place, and maybe something you can do to elevate your beer to the next level. Even a 42-point beer can become a 45. You know, until you get to that 50-point beer, there's always a little bit of something that you can improve on your beer. And as a judge, you're not the be-all, end-all opinion on what that person needs to do, but what you're doing is you're giving your honest and educated opinion on what you feel that person needs to do to elevate that beer, or maybe why it's not quite the style, or you know, some of the flaws you perceive, whether they are there or are not, nobody else can say because they don't have your palate. You need to do the best that you can to articulate to that entrant what you're tasting and how they can fix what you're perceiving. Would you want to get a score sheet back with no information on why you received the score you did? If you received a score of a 25, wouldn't you like to know maybe what that judge was tasting? I mean, was it even your beer? I mean, I know somebody who entered a competition and got feedback on a beer that clearly was not even his. And it happens, you know, somewhere along the line, somebody mislabeled his bottle with somebody else's, and, you know, it happens. So it's important to be able to articulate what you are tasting, what you're smelling, what you're feeling as far as mouthfeel and your overall impression, because that could give the entrant a good idea on whether there was a mistake made, and if not, maybe why they didn't receive the score they were expecting. It's a lack of good feedback that gives judging a bad rap. On all the forums and some of the Facebook groups that are out there, competitions tend to leave a sour taste in some people's mouths, and it's not necessarily because of inaccurate feedback all the time. Mostly it's for lack of feedback. The consensus of people that are upset are always upset because of, I'll show you a score sheet I received shortly in this video, and you'll see why people get upset about competitions sometimes. And so don't worry quite so much about being inaccurate. You got to do the best you can with your palate. You know, the judge or the beer that you have sitting in front of you may not be the same beer that person is drinking at home, because you don't know how that beer was handled during shipping. It could have been hot, thrown around a UPS or FedEx truck. The storage at the competition may not have been ideal. It could have been sitting out for a while. You could be drinking that beer considerably warmer than that person who's pulling it directly from their tap at home. So don't worry about being inaccurate as far as what the entrant may feel is inaccurate. Just make sure that you're able to tell what you are perceiving at that moment. And please, if you don't want to be a judge, don't be a judge. Don't, you know, the BJCP does need good judges. I'm not denying that. I'd hate to, you know, have people say, well, this guy that's doing this class says don't be a judge. And I'm not saying that. If you want to be a judge, please you know, be a judge, but be a good judge. If you are getting into judging to be able to tell your friends, I'm a beer judge, I'm a certified beer judge, no one really cares, you know, to be quite honest with you. It's something that you do to give back to the home brewing community and to help out other brewers. You're not really impressing anybody by saying, I'm a certified beer judge, so blah, 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 blah. All you're doing, you know, by taking a course like this and developing your palate is just trying to give back, trying to help others, and help yourself as well as for being able to evaluate your own beer. But don't get into it for the ego trip, because it's really not there. So let me ask you, I'm going to show you two score sheets here. Which score sheet would you rather receive? Would you rather receive this score sheet, or would you rather receive this score sheet? The first score sheet that I'm showing you is an actual sheet that I received from a beer that I entered into a competition, and this is the feedback that I received. So the second one, because I didn't want to pull anybody else's out if they recognized handwriting or anything like that, but this is my score sheet from my that I filled out for my retake of the judging exam in 2013. So I just want to compare the two between what is a good score sheet and what is a very poorly written score sheet. I also want to say that the score sheet you're looking at on the right is exactly the same type of score sheet and the same type of feedback that you would get from me in a competition. I don't put any more effort into when I took the exam as to when I'm evaluating a beer in competition. I personally feel that's the way it should be. I do know a lot of people put forth a lot of effort during their exam, and then when they get their rank, they just kind of breeze through the competitions. And you really shouldn't be doing that. You should always be doing the best you can with what you're able to do. So let's take a look at this first score sheet. And let me ask you, would you rather receive a score sheet like this that says under aroma, good malty aroma, and then you get a 6? So why did I lose 6 points? First of all, what were the hops like? What else were you perceiving? Were there any faults? I also should point out that on here it says category 2B. I could tell you that I know for a fact that it's not 2B because I have never entered a competition in category 2B. This is actually was entered as a Doppelbach. And the other score sheets that I received, because I received another score sheet for this one, they were correct. They were in the Doppelbach category. This person, they just put whatever. 2B, entry 17, no subcategory listed. They should have that listed. Good malty aroma, nothing else. Appearance, nice something head. So all they're commenting on is the head of the beer. I got 2 out of 3. No indication of the color, clarity, whether it's within style. Under flavor, it just says buttery. This Doppelbach to this person was buttery, but must not have had any malt aroma, no hops, no fermentation characteristics, no esters, nothing. But I scored a 7 just for it being buttery. I don't know if it was very buttery to them, if it was a high level of diacetyl, or if it was low, moderate. I have no clue. But all I know is whatever it is, they took 13 points off for buttery. Under mouthfeel, I don't know what this means, but everything is circled, so I don't know if that means it's lacking or if it means it was present. I'm assuming it must have been present since I got 3 out of 5. And under overall impression, I think it says off beer or it could be okay beer, one of the two, but that is their overall impression. No feedback on how I can improve, no indication of why out of 50 I got 23, other than it says buttery up here. But if you look at the check boxes on this side, evidently I've got some diacetyl, some DMS. It was oxidized. So I guess nothing's indicated over here. And that is an example of a very, very piss-poor score sheet. If you look at this score sheet, It's got the category listed, subcategory, and you try to list the levels, you know, faint notes of chocolate as well as some banana, clove, and blah, blah, blah. All, you know, you try to list the levels, you know, the color, you know, deep amber as opposed to like a light amber, a little bit of cloudiness as opposed to it being crystal clear or very hazy. So you see the difference between the two and how much information is given for the two beers. And relatively speaking, these two beers score in the roughly the same category in the good, you know, the 21 to 29 range. But there's a lot more information given here than what's given over here. There's a reason why, there's suggestions on how to fix it, and so that is what you're looking for, the difference between a good score sheet and the score sheets that everybody's complaining about. So here's a few do's and don'ts as far as when you're filling out a score sheet. Do, complete honest feedback of what you're detecting in the moment. What I mean by that is reading the guidelines when you're in competition and you're reading the guidelines, just don't recite back basically what the guidelines say. The way that I do it personally is I fill out my aroma, my appearance, my flavor, my mouthfeel, my overall impression. I fill out everything that I was getting as far as all of those attributes of the beer. Then I go look at the guidelines and I see, according to what I'm detecting, whether it's in style, out of style, whether it's allowed, or whether it's something that's absolutely not allowed, and I'll make notes from that point on whether or not it's allowed per style or not. Fill in as much white space as possible based on your findings. As you saw in the previous score sheet, you know, you don't have to make sure that you fill out every single line with flowery information. Fill it with pertinent information. As long as the beer has flavor and aroma to it, you should be able to fill out what you're smelling, what you're tasting, what you're feeling. And if it just happens to not fill all the white space, you did the best that you could. At least you provided the information that you're detecting, and you don't just write buttery and leave it at that. Make sure you hit on all the key points listed in the score sheet. For example, under, you know, we're going to look at a blank score sheet in a minute and go over all of the parts of it. But if you look under aroma, it tells you to comment on the malt, the hops, the esters, and other flavor characteristics. So you want to list what type of malt flavors or aromas that you're getting, what type of hop flavors or aromas are you getting, and at what levels. Any estery flavors or aromas, or lack of. If you don't get any esters, write in there. No esters detected. And just make sure underneath you hit all of those key points. If you hit all of those key points, I promise you, you will not have a hard time filling out all of the white space on a score sheet. Judge the beer in front of you according to the guidelines, not the beer that you want it to be or the beer that you think it should be. What I mean by this is somebody enters a beer in, let's say, you know, I like to always pick on the American Pale Ale because it's a very common style that you're going to run into. If somebody enters an American Pale Ale, judge that beer in front of you according to the guidelines, not according to the best American Pale Ale you've ever had and then just keep comparing it to that beer. You know, this is not a Sierra Nevada Pale Ale and all that, because the guidelines are a range. The guidelines don't tell you it should taste like a clone of XYZ beer. It's giving you a range. So judge that beer in that range. Don't judge it according to a single beer that you hold as the best beer that you've ever had in that style. A great tasting beer can score low if it's miscategorized. I should mention that, because somebody may have entered 5 beers into a competition, and one of those beers may be a stout, and another one could be, you know, a German Pilsner. And just by mistake, they accidentally swapped their bottles, put the labels on the wrong bottles, and sent them off. It happens. So you're sitting at that German Pilsner table, and you get a black beer that pours out. You ask the organizer or the head steward or the head judge, whoever in that competition you're instructed to bring these sort of things up with, and you make sure, is this the right beer for this table? And if it is, then you judge that beer as it is in front of you, and you score it according to that guideline, and then you make a suggestion. This beer actually would be a better dry stout than a German Pilsner, and that person may get that score sheet back, and then they'll get their score sheet back from that stout talking about how it should be a German Pilsner, and they could say, huh, looks like I swapped my bottles, you know, my bad, but at least I got some decent feedback on how those beers taste or if they had any flaws. Don't feel you have to match the comments with the judge who's across from you. A lot of people always want everything to be exactly the same. But we're humans. Our palates are different, and we perceive things at different levels, in different intensities, and you need to write down what you are perceiving. Whether or not the person across from you gets that or not is completely irrelevant, irregardless of what other people think. They think judges should be robots, and everybody should detect the same exact things at the same exact levels. All feedback for every beer should be identical. In a perfect world, that would be true. But we're not perfect, and we're human, and you do the best that you can with what your body tells you, and that's what you need to do. Don't feel you have to match scores. In most cases, you need to come within 5 to 7 points in agreement, if possible. When you come up with your final scores, you know, you say you score this beer at 25, and the judge across from you scores it at 38. What's going to happen is you then talk about what you like about the beer, what you didn't like about the beer, why you scored it low, maybe why he scored it high. Talk about the guidelines. That is actually the fun part of judging, is the discussion that can take place during a disagreement, as long as they don't get heated and personal. But it does happen. I mean, sometimes you may be perceiving something that other judge doesn't get. And as you're talking to them, they may realize, hey, you know, he's right or she's right. This aroma that I'm picking up is not appropriate for this style, so maybe I need to come down a little bit. Or the other way may be true. You may be dinging a beer that has a little bit of diacetyl in it, but you're judging an English bitter, which is allowed to have a little bit of diacetyl in it, and you dinged it for having some, and you know, you may need to come up because that is allowed in that style. So don't feel that the scores need to match point for point. You guys are both doing a 25, or you guys are both doing a 38, but you do need to come within 5 to 7 points in agreement. There are times where you absolutely, positively will not agree, and neither judge refuses to budge. That happens sometimes. And in that case, one of two things usually happens. You either bring in a third judge as a tiebreaker to taste a beer and give their opinion, or you just agree to have that widespread and average the two scores in the middle. Like I said earlier, we're not machines. You may not pick up on faults that the judge across from you gets, and vice versa. Those faults that judge across from you may be getting may not even exist. So it happens sometimes where a judge may perceive some things as diacetyl. They may be getting a malt flavor or aroma that's actually more toffee-like, but they may be thinking it's butterscotch, so right away they jump on that diacetyl train. And you may be listing on your score sheet that it's has a nice toffee-like flavor. Both of you are right, because that judge is perceiving what he thinks is what his body is telling him. You're doing the same. But you need to stick by your guns as far as your perceptions and just go with what you're getting, and try not to be influenced by somebody telling you, because I've seen this happen too. You'll have a higher ranking judge telling a lower ranking judge what they're tasting. And to a point, that's part of the learning process. But if you really are not getting, you know, you're not detecting that, you're not detecting it, and that's fine. That judge may be getting it, or he may be wrong. So, if somebody across from you says, I'm getting a little buttery, you know, flavor in this beer, retaste it, see if you taste it. Sometimes the power of suggestion will put it there. Sometimes you just being aware that it's there will allow you to actually grow as a judge and develop your palate. Like, oh, that's what butter would taste like in a stout. Because, to be honest, sometimes those flavors can be difficult to pick up in a more roasty beer compared to a cream ale or a pilsner. And don't go looking for faults, because you will trick yourself into finding them. There are a ton of people out there that they'll find something wrong with every single beer. And sometimes it's the same fault. I have seen people, and I know some people, that every beer has diacetyl in it, no matter what. If it's a homebrew, it's got diacetyl. If it's a commercial beer, oh, it's beautiful. But every homebrew that they have has diacetyl in it, unless, of course, they're not told that it's a homebrew that they're drinking, which is kind of funny sometimes, but that's neither here nor there. And, you know, there's people that I know like that, you know, from judging at various places around the state, you get to know a few people, and sometimes you get to know what their sensitivities are, and same, you know, same with you, they'll get to know you. But, like I said, don't go looking for faults, because you will trick yourself into finding them. Just be honest with what you're tasting, and don't go searching for things. Let things develop on your palate. So here are parts of a score sheet. We're going to just start on one side, and we're going to work our way clockwise. We're going to start with our name, ID, and email. That's pretty self-explanatory. You should fill that out on every score sheet. You put your full name, your BJCP ID, if you have one. Some competitions you'll be able to judge before you take an exam. You'll be able to get a little bit of experience ahead of time. But if you have a BJCP ID, you put it in there, and you put your email in. So if the entrant has any questions or problems with the score sheet, they can contact you. In the next section over, you have the entry info. That's where you list the category number, the subcategory, the entry number. Those usually are listed on the bottle that you get at the table. And then you write down the subcategory, just for clarification. Just like in the score sheet you saw earlier that said 2B, German Pilsner, I believe 2B is. And so you would write German Pils on there. If you're judging one of the specialty categories, you write down any special ingredients that the entrant has listed, be it toasted coconut, oak, what type of fruit is in there, any special ingredients, go ahead and write those on that line. Then you look at the bottle fill, and as long as it's appropriately filled and there's no pellicle and everything looks good, check that little box. Down below that, in the blue section, is the meat and potatoes of the score sheet, basically. Under aroma, this is where I'm talking about. It says comment on malt, hops, esters, and other characteristics. I think it's kind of hard to read because it's kind of small, but under each one of these, if you look at a score sheet, it says comment on color, clarity, head, and then in parentheses under head, you need to talk about retention, color, and texture of the head. You know, same under flavor, comment on malt, hops, fermentation characteristics, balance, finish, aftertaste, any other flavor components, mouthfeel, comment on body, carbonation, warmth, creaminess, astringency, and any other palate sensations. And then under your overall impression, that's where you're going to take in the whole beer as a whole unit, talk about how much you liked it, how much it fit to style or did not fit to style, and any suggested feedback you have would occur down here. So these keywords that I'm talking about underneath are very important. You will do fairly well on your judging exam, as long as you mention every single keyword under here. that is one of the biggest mistakes that I see when I'm judging an exam is skipping hops. If hops are not present, people will tend to skip them in some of the more malt-forward beers. They won't comment on the hops at all. If you don't get any hop aroma, right in there, no hop aroma. Boom, you have just hit that keyword and you get credit for it. If you're not detecting any malt, which is almost impossible in most beers, you normally get some degree of malt, considering the grain bill is, you know, aside from water, that's the next biggest ingredient in your beer is going to be your grain. But comment, you know, no malt detected. So make sure you hit all these keywords underneath and you'll be able to fill this white space perfectly. Next, you have your scores. You have 12 points for aroma, 3 points for appearance, 20 points for flavor, 5 points for mouthfeel, 10 points for overall impression. That adds up to 50 points. Once you put in your scores along here and you add them up, that's your where your total score goes. The style matrix helps you indicate to the entrant whether it's a classic example or it's not style at all. So, you know, a beer that is a 45 or 38 will be way up here. A beer that's down in the 13 to 14 range, unless it's because the reason it's there is because it's heavily faulted, is normally not going to be to style. Here's the scoring guide. When you are tasting that beer, you have outstanding, excellent, very good, good, fair, problematic. You need to keep these number ranges in mind with your overall score and your overall impression. That's one thing to make note of in here. If you put in here, this is a very good beer, you better be in this 30 to 37 range. Otherwise, you'd be better off putting, this is an excellent representation of this beer. So be aware of these scoring ranges. Pay close attention to them and make sure that they match up how you feel that that beer is. You know, a very good beer is 30 to 37 points. That's what I always shoot for, is I'm hoping that every beer that I enter is in the 30-point range or higher. Next, you have your fault descriptors. Any faults that you list over here, say it's a buttery, say it's astringent, if you list astringency down here, if it's oxidized, check these checkboxes just for clarification for the entrant, because it does give a little bit more information on what oxidized is. If you say it's papery or sherry-like, you know, and you check the oxidized box, it does give them just a touch bit more information to go off of. And finally, this I fill out as I fill this out, is your rank. This is your credentials, so that the entrant knows maybe what level you're at and what to expect from your score sheet. Anything from a national or master or honorary master, I'm hoping is going to be a bit more thorough than somebody at the recognized or apprentice range. Certified, those can go either way. I know some certified judges that are absolutely phenomenal judges. They just haven't scored well in the test for one reason or another. But if you get something from a national or a master, I'm expecting this to be filled out to the nines and just have it be as accurate and full of information as what you can fit on a score sheet. I would like to mention real quickly, there's another score sheet some of you may be familiar with as far as if you've entered in the NHC this year. These checkbox style score sheets are making their way into more and more competitions as competitions get larger and larger. These score sheets, personally, I don't care for them. I've used them. Some people absolutely love them because they're so much faster. And they say that you can get the same type of feedback that you give to an entrant as far as writing things out in prose form. You know, you have your low, medium, high, medium, low, medium, high ranges. So just to look at this aroma, you detect some malt, medium, and let's say it's grainy or caramely, bready, or a combination of these, you would check each one of these that you perceive. Same with hops, same with esters, and other aroma characteristics. What I don't like is sometimes some of these don't really describe the full spectrum of malt flavors or aromas that you can get. Same with hops. Right now, a lot of the newer hop varieties coming out are quite tropical. You have some mango, some pineapple that's making its way in. And as you can see, that's not even a choice in here. So you do have some room to write, but it's really not all that much room. That's why I personally don't care for these. I would prefer it if the areas to write your comments was a little bigger, but I just want you to be aware that these score sheets you could come across in a competition, and that's how you fill them out. You have your ranges, none. You've got a beer that's got no hops, you know, no hop aroma to it. You check that off, and I just leave those blank. You know, same for appearance, flavor, mouthfeel, all of this. This is where you'd put your feedback and your overall score. Here's where you check all your flaws, and down below, whether you detected it in the aroma, flavor, or the mouthfeel. As you can see, some things like astringency, you can get in flavor, mouthfeel. Not all that familiar with getting astringency and aroma, but it's an option that's there. And if they're grayed out, that means generally don't get light struck in the mouthfeel. But take a good look at the score sheet. It's making its way out there a little more, especially if you end up judging these gigantic competitions like the NHC. You're going to see a lot of these. These score sheets are not intended to give as much feedback as the original score sheet is. These are meant to be quick. Here's what the beer is. Maybe here's a quick way to fix it and move on. These score sheets are meant to be filled out quickly. So here's some keys to filling out a really good score sheet. I can't stress this enough. Write something about every keyword that's listed under aroma, appearance, flavor, mouthfeel, and overall descriptors. If a keyword says to list something and you don't get that, as I've been stressing this whole time through, say no astringency. If it says under mouthfeel to talk about astringency, well, that beer is not astringent in any way, shape, or form, so I'm going to write no astringency. Never write anything stating how the beer was brewed. This is another common one that I will see on score sheets, both in competition and on exams, is some people really feel that they want to prove how good their palate is, and they can tell the difference between an extract and an all-grain brew, or they can tell if this beer has been decocted or not. No, that doesn't happen. A very, very rare individual will actually be able to tell that. And I, in my homebrew club, I actually did a little blind testing. I brewed a beer that was all grain, and I brewed the same beer, I converted it to extract. So I brewed an extract and all grain version of the same beer. I didn't tell a single person in the club that I did this. What I did is I brought that beer into one of our meetings, and I brought two growlers, and I just said, hey guys, I got two beers here. I just want your opinion on which beer you prefer. And I had everybody vote. And lo and behold, the extract beer actually came out ahead. As far, I think it was a pretty narrow margin though, but the extract beer was preferred. The second part of that is, you know, I said I want you to taste it, tell me which one you prefer. I also did mention that there is one difference between the two beers, and I would like you to write down what you think that difference is. Not a single person in the club put down one's an extract and one's an all grain. I had everything from type of yeast used to one of them had more hops to it, but which is all fine because the beers really were not identical. But not a single person keyed in on one was an extract and one was an all grain brew. I think that's very important to put out there that a lot of these people, they say they can pick out an extract beer because they've put it in their brain that they're able to do it. Well, you've got a 50-50 shot at being able to pick it out. So these one or two beers maybe that they get wrong, they're attributing that to something else other than the odds of flipping a coin. Because I could flip a coin 10 times, and 7 out of 10 times I can get it right, and get it wrong 3 times. Well, does that mean that I know that it's going to come up heads or tails? So I know I kind of went off on a tangent on that one, but it's very important on a score sheet because you lose credibility if you tell somebody to, sparge at a, you know, they over-sparged or whatever, and it's an extract beer, and they're like, oh, you know, you lose credibility. So what you should do is when you're giving feedback, you should say, if you brewed extract, then do this. If this beer is all grain, then you may have over-sparged and, you know, you're getting a little astringency. So it's very important not to state that you know how this beer was brewed, because you don't. There's a number of factors that could come into play for both extract, all grain, or various mashing or sparging techniques that you don't always know, and you just really need to be aware of that. Avoid vague descriptions, like saying hoppy aroma or malty. That doesn't cut it on the, I can tell you it doesn't cut it on the exam at all. And when you're giving feedback to an entrant, they already know that their American Pale Ale has a hoppy aroma. Maybe they want to know, maybe they're not too good at picking out what those aromas are. So by telling them that you're getting a mango or a citrusy or piney or resinous aroma, that helps them key in a little bit to, oh, okay, I kind of get what that citrusy hop aroma is all about. Citrus hop aroma, grapefruity, spicy, and other descriptors along those lines are much better. You should always try to avoid just saying American hop aroma, because Simcoe and Citra are both American hops, but they smell and taste completely different. Same goes for, you know, Cascade or any of these. There's a lot of new hops coming out now, and they all taste different than what you're traditionally used to with the C hops, the old citrusy, grapefruity, piney hops. There's a lot more flavor and aroma components coming into play, which is making the American IPA and the American Pale Ale and other American beer styles so much more vibrant and diverse. And unfortunately, a lot of judges, I shouldn't say a lot, but some judges haven't caught up to the times yet, and they're still fully in that citrus hop flavor and aroma mode. And if you enter an American Pale Ale or American IPA and you're getting a tropical fruit aroma or flavor, I do know some people are getting dinged for that, and that's pretty unfortunate, because there's a lot of hops out there that are putting all these aromas and flavors out there. So just something to be aware of. Always give a suggestion on a way to improve on a beer if it didn't score a 50, even if it's minor. If you score a beer of 45, you should tell that entrant why it wasn't a 50. And that, when you get into those high-scoring beers, those 40, 45-point beers and up, you're really nitpicking. So, you know, anything, even in regards to just being a slight bit too dark or anything like that, anything that you can give that entrant to maybe improve on why you didn't give them the perfect score. And by that token, like I'm saying, if you list a fault, you should always give a suggestion on how to eliminate that fault. Even if it sounds like basic brewing to you, you know, something like ensuring a vigorous uncovered boil to drive off DMS, that may sound like a very basic thing that everybody is doing, but based off of being a member of a forum on Facebook, there's a lot of new brewers out there, a lot more than I ever realized. Like people just starting out like today, and they're they're thinking if I cover my pot is going to come to a boil faster. And they're right. But they don't take that lid off. And so you don't know if that brewer is brewing, if this beer that they're sending into competition is their first, their fifth, or their 500th. You don't know. So always give a suggestion based on what the fault is, and list the most common reasons for that fault, and then maybe one or two less common corrections for that fault, because you know DMS can come about from not only not having a rapid enough boil, it can also come about from keeping the lid on, but it can also come about from too slow of a cooling process, because DMS precursors are still being produced in that hot wort until you reduce it down below 120 degrees or so. So if they're cooling their beer very slow, or they're doing the no cool method that some people are, or the no chill method, which some people are starting to do, you may have slightly higher levels of DMS, especially if they use something like a Pilsner malt, which is notorious for having high levels of DMS. So all I'm saying here is basically just give feedback. Even if it sounds like it's basic troubleshooting to you, give feedback. If a beer is not to style in the category that it's entered, but it would fit better into another style, say so. And don't just say this beer would do better in a different style. Don't leave it at that, because that entrant's they may not know, they're going to be confused. So suggest to them where you feel that beer would have done better. Say, this beer did not fit to style, but this beer would do better as a Doppelbock than it would as a traditional Bock. Okay? That's going to help somebody out a lot more than just saying this beer didn't really fit to style. So vocabulary is very important when filling out score sheets. Use common terminology. I ran across this one time. Somebody was trying to describe a beer, and they described it as old lacquered cherry planks sitting forgotten about in the back of a barn for years. Now, this is not a sensation that most people can relate to. And this is a true story, that somebody really did write that. So a better way to voice that same type of feel would be to say it's oaky, booze-soaked cherries. Most of us have had cherry bounce or some other type of booze and cherries or something along those lines. And other barnyard-like descriptors like a goaty or like a horse blanket or hay-like would be a much better to describe than to say an old lacquered cherry planks sitting forgotten about in the back of a barn for years. To me, that's absolutely ridiculous. So no need to get overly flowery to prove how sophisticated your palate is. You're not impressing anybody but yourself. You're actually going to be confusing people by using descriptors like that. If the person reading your score sheets can't relate to the description, what's the point in filling it out? You're filling it out for them. You're not filling it out for you. However, by the same token, there's no flavor or aroma that's off limits. I've had beers that have smelled like wet leaves, toasted marshmallows, sautéed mushrooms. These are all flavors and aromas that I've gotten in the past. So just, keep it simple. Be honest with what you're smelling or what you're tasting. You know, I didn't describe them as wet autumn leaves resting quietly in the Shire after being trampled by albino unicorns, but I did mention, it had the aroma of wet leaves. So be honest about something like that. So building your vocabulary is easy. In order to build your vocabulary, all you need to do is start paying attention to the foods and drinks and aromas of outside and things around you. Pay close attention to these flavors and aromas in everyday life the best that you can. Once you become a lot more attuned to, the smells of things like paint or, wet leaves or what be it, you're going to become much better at articulating that onto a score sheet. So things you could say instead of malty. I'm going to run through these really quickly. So instead of just saying malty aroma or malty flavor, you could say a nice malty backbone consisting of biscuity, bready, brown sugar, caramel-like, chocolate, cracker-like, crusty, corn, grainy, honey, husky. Husky can also be an astringent flavor or aroma. Melanoidin. A lot of people are familiar with the flavors and aromas of melanoidins in the grain or breads and things like that. So that's a good one to use. Molasses, nutty, raisiny, roasty, toasty, toffee, even treacle. Instead of just saying hoppy aroma or flavor, hops can be catty. They can be cheesy if they're old. They can be citrusy. They can be either sweet or bitter orange. Those flavors are pretty common. Grapefruit is very common. Lemon is becoming more prevalent, but it's still a little uncommon. There are some hops that have a lime character to them, and tangerines. Hops can be fruity. You can be peach, pineapple, nectarines, mango, apricots, both in flavor and aroma. Hops can be grassy. They can be herbal, like oregano, rosemary, thyme, parsley. They can be minty, piney, resinous. When I'm talking resinous, a lot of times what I think of is tree sap is what I think of when I think of something that's resinous. Real bitter, kind of sticky, sticks to your teeth type of flavors and feel. They can be spicy, they can be soapy, and they can be woody. Instead of just saying yeasty, even if you just say Belgian yeast, a lot of people are fairly familiar with the Belgian styles, and they do have a specific characteristic to them, and while Belgian wouldn't be an official flavor or aroma descriptor, using that is better than just saying yeasty. Estery is a profile of fermentation, so that can be part of something that the yeast are giving off. You can get esters of pears, bananas, passion fruit, and so on. Yeast can be meaty, especially if it's not filtered and you're getting a little yeast in your glass. A lot of phenols are coming as a byproduct of the yeast. Phenols can be smoky, they can be spicy, like cloves, or they can be pretty off-putting. They can be medicinal, plastic, tannic, or astringent. You can get some peppery and other spicy flavors and aromas from the yeast, like vanilla, cumin, allspice, nutmeg, those type of spicy and peppery flavors and aromas can come from the yeast, and sulfur. So, this is just a really quick rundown of some descriptors for filling out a score sheet, master through apprentice, in aroma. An apprentice may say, malty, hoppy, nice aroma. That's apprentice level aroma right there. A recognized judge will say, good hoppy aroma, some sweet malt, some DMS. A certified level judge will say something like, nice citrus hop aroma, moderate bready malt, some caramel malt, nice balance of aroma, no esters, low level of DMS. As you can see, they hit all the points. They commented on hops, malt, esters, and other aroma characteristics. But they didn't really take it to the next level by describing the levels or more specific aromas or flavors. That's what you're expecting from a national judge. A national judge will say high citrus hop aroma, moderate bready malt with low level of caramel malt as a secondary aroma. No fruity esters, no diacetyl, some low DMS as the beer warms, which means they went back and smelled it after their initial evaluation. As the beer warms, the beer becomes more caramel-like. A master level judge will up that just another notch, and they will say a high level of American citrus hops, some hints of mango, so they're getting more into the citrusy and even some secondary aromas that may be going on in there. Moderate bready malt with low levels of caramel malt as a secondary aroma. No fruity esters, no diacetyl, some low DMS. And then they go on to tell you that DMS is not appropriate for this style. As the beer warms, caramel becomes more pronounced and DMS is actually going down. So let's look at appearance for the same set of judges. An apprentice will say gold, good head, hazy. Okay, apprentice is normally somebody who scored on their exam below passing, which is 60 and below. recognized will be 60 to 70, certified 70 to 80, national is 80 to 90, and master is 90 and up. So a recognized judge will say color is gold, nice head, well-formed, a bit hazy. So they hit several of the key points, and they were a little vague, but they did okay. A certified judge will hit everything. Though the color is gold, pours a moderate white head that persists, good retention. A national judge will say golden color, it pours a moderate head, good retention. Head color is white with tight bubbles, beer's a bit hazy, and has some nice lacing. Master judge may say it's golden color, pours a moderate 1-inch frothy head with good retention. Head color is white with tight bubbles, beer's a bit hazy, which is okay for that style, because that style may have had some dry hopping in it. Some nice lacing, and head persists throughout the glass. So I think you see a pattern here. Let's look at something with flavor. An apprentice would say, full-bodied, kind of malty, bitter, tastes good. A recognized judge would say something like, malt is sweet and caramely, hops are good, some citrus in there, bitterness is good, good flavor for style, clean. Certified judge will say sweet malt up front, mostly caramel-like. Bitterness is good for the style. It's about medium, so they're giving you some ranges there. Hop flavor is mostly citrus, fairly clean fermentation, no noticeable esters. Initially sweet, but finishes dry, hops linger. So you can see they hit every point under flavor. They're just slightly vague. Now, what you would expect from a national judge should be sweet caramel malt up front, some bready notes. Hop flavor is medium, mostly grapefruit and pine. Bitterness is assertive, but within style. Fermentation profile is clean. No esters or diacetyl. Low DMS cooked corn flavor. Balance is decidedly towards the hops, as it should be in the style. Starts mildly sweet, but finishes dry, with a nice lingering bitterness that's not harsh. Hop flavor also persists. A master judge pretty much says the same things as a national judge. Usually they just say it a little better. They might give a little bit more detail. You know, so this master judge will say sweet caramel malt up front, some bready notes. Hop flavor is medium and showcases traditional American hop varieties. So they're telling you it's the traditional American hop varieties, not anything anything that's way out of bounds. They're telling you it's mostly grapefruit and pine. There may be some tropical fruit, mango, as detected in the aroma, so he went back, compared it to his aroma. Bitterness is assertive, but within style. Fermentation is clean, no esters or diacetyl. Some low-level DMS, cooked corn, so they're telling you what type of DMS they're getting here. Balance is decidedly towards the hops, as it should be in the style. Beer starts slightly sweet, but finishes dry, thanks in part to the hop bitterness. Finishes with a lingering hop presence, some bitterness, and citrus hop flavor. So, let's look at mouthfeel. Apprentice will say medium body, carbonation good. Recognized would say something along the lines of light to medium body, carbonation is moderate to high. So they're giving ranges. That's one thing you shouldn't do, should not give ranges. It has a nice feel. A certified judge will say medium light body, carbonation is moderate, some noticeable alcohol warmth. A national judge will say medium bodied, carbonation is moderate, low alcohol warmth. Nice creamy mouthfeel with some very low astringency. A master will say pretty much the same. Medium body, carbonation is medium, okay for style. So they added that little note in there. Low alcohol warmth, nice creamy mouthfeel. It's not slick. Some very low hop drive astringency. So they've determined that this astringency isn't from the grain, but more than likely from the hops. Hop astringency is not really appropriate in American pale ale. So they're judging an American pale ale. I should have mentioned that earlier on, but this hypothetical beer was an American pale ale. And hop astringency, while allowed in an IPA, is not allowed in an American pale ale or a double IPA. So because it's not allowed in American pale ale, they're telling you why this might be dinged a little bit, while in some of the more assertively hoppy beers, like your IPAs and double IPAs, a little hop-derived astringency may be allowed, but not in this one. So, our overall impressions. The apprentice is going to say beer is okay for an American pale ale. A recognized judge will say this is a very good example of an American pale ale, maybe needs to work on reducing DMS, but otherwise a good job. So they gave a little bit of feedback, but they didn't really tell you how to do it. A certified judge will say a very good American Pale Ale, very drinkable, and I enjoyed the sample. A few suggestions would be to slightly reduce the bittering hops and boil a bit longer to reduce the DMS. So that's a little bit better. National judge will say this is a very good American Pale Ale. With a few minor tweaks, you could bump this recipe into a world-class example. The DMS could be reduced by a longer, more vigorous boil. Also, if you placed your lid on the brew pot, you may want to remove it and boil open. So they said if, and they're not telling the brewer that he did. They're saying if you placed the lid on the pot, just be aware. You know, and they also gave another suggestion, because a longer or more vigorous boil will reduce DMS as well. The astringency could possibly be reduced by hop choice. The hazy beer makes me think it could possibly have been dry hopped. Maybe reduce the dry hop length. Again, very good beer. Master Judge will say a very good example of an American Pale Ale. With a few minor tweaks, you could bump this recipe up to a world-class example. They basically say the same thing as the National Judge. The astringency could be reduced by hop choice. Seek out varieties with a low cohumulone level. Some hops that have high cohumulone levels will give you a little bit more of a harsh bitterness and tend to be a little bit more astringent, especially if you're going to be dry hopping with beer, with hops that have a high cohumulone level. So this master judge kind of took that to the next level by not only saying reduce by hop choice, but they're also telling you why. He's telling you seek out varieties with a low cohumulone level. And perhaps reducing some of the high alpha hops or dry hopping during duration as well. Very good beer. So 6 hints. We're going to be closing out the class pretty quick. 6 hints for filling out an outstanding score sheet. These will be just a recap. So make it easy on the graders and make it easy on the contestants, because they will notice and it will make a difference. Write legibly. Try to avoid writing in cursive if you can. Take your time and ensure that the pencil is sharp. There's nothing more difficult than trying to read somebody's cursive and their scribblings. And if the pencil is dull, it tends to blur a little bit, especially when you're getting copies. Don't abbreviate. People aren't always going to know what your abbreviations mean. Never assume. So never assume that the beer was extract or all-grained, or never assume what they did. You can make a suggestion. If you do make a suggestion, say, if you did this, then do this. Make sure you hit on every keyword listed under aroma, flavor, appearance, and overall impression and mouthfeel. Don't be overly flowery in your descriptions and use common terms. It's always a good idea in your feedback to use something that I learned when teaching people certain things is you do a praise, correct praise. So you'll say, this is a very good beer, or whatever, very good malt. If you got to try to find at least one good attribute to the beer, even if the beer is horribly flawed. Hopefully you can find one thing right with it. Say, this beer had excellent clarity. Here's all your faults. Please try to correct these faults. Again, the color looked beautiful. Thank you for sending it in, whatever. So praise, correct praise. That is a good way to get your points across. People tend to be more responsive to praise, correct praise than correct hammer, correct hammer, correct hammer. You're a bad brewer. So something to keep in mind. That closes.